Simon & Schuster Audio presents A Chosen Destiny, My Story, by Drew McIntyre, with Sarah Edworthy. Read by Drew McIntyre. The statements and opinions expressed in this work are solely those of the author and do not reflect the views of the WWE. WWE hereby disclaims any responsibility for such statements and opinions, and they should not be construed as representing WWE's position on any subject.
Prologue. Come on, man, don't arrest me. April 5th, 2020. The dishes are washed, cats fed, the trash taken out. We've pulled the bamboo blinds across the big sliding doors that look out across a cluster of palm trees and the lake and switched on some dim lighting. With a large bowl of popcorn, we're now sitting in one of our favorite spots in the world, the big cream leather wraparound sofa that's in the heart of our living room. To my left, Caitlin is huddled in a huge blanket. She's cold, as usual. On my lap sits a 20-pound black cat. All the males in our household fall into the heavyweight category. We're not the most outgoing people. We like to stay inside, happy in our own company, hanging out with our cats, Chaz and Hunter. It could have been any old evening in front of Netflix, but this was not any old evening. It is fast approaching 7 p.m. on Sunday, the second night of WrestleMania 36. With a casual flick of the remote and a stomach full of butterflies, I am preparing for a surreal but freaking cool out-of-body experience. I'm going to watch myself fulfill my destiny live on a 60-inch TV screen. It counts as an out-of-body experience because I am two distinctive selves. One self is me, here, sitting very comfortably, stroking Chaz and picking at popcorn next to my wife, who is not the biggest fan of wrestling, at home in St. Petersburg in the Tampa Bay area of Florida. My other self is about 100 miles down the road at the Performance Center in Orlando, where I'm about to stalk menacingly in the ring to beat up Brock Lesnar, the most dominant champion in the history of WWE. I'm hovering between two dimensions. I am here, but not here. I am happily sitting here in jeans and a black t-shirt, and I am spray-tanned, hairy Scottish Terminator from Claymore Country, relentlessly pacing up the locker room, hauling my trademark leather duster over my trunks, soon to be embroiled in the most physically and mentally demanding form of competitive combat known on the planet. A heavyweight world championship match against the evil, chuckling muscle mountain known as the Beast Incarnate. Crazy, right? Paranormal, even. Which is kind of fitting, as I've always had an interest in supernatural phenomena. Images of my grandmother's flash across my mind. My Nana, who showed me the power of the other dimension, with a glass whizzing across her Ouija board, and who made me promise never to toy with her tarot cards. And Gran, Dad's mum, who would read tea leaves to divine the future, but gave up when she started foreseeing awful things happening to her friends. Can you see it? Can you see it? She would say, showing us the leaves at the bottom of the cup. No, we never could. Over the years, I have learned that when you compound the hard commercial requirements of WWE with the strange reality that television imposes on the world, the results can often be paranormal in ways that would have amazed both of my grandmothers. But this was a situation even more bizarre. For 19 years, I've been imagining exactly how I would one day wrench the WWE title from a storied superstar and shake the title above my head with a roar of triumph, reveling in being the main event of the annual laser flick fireworks spectacle that is WrestleMania. I have a whole back catalogue of dream scenario montages in my head. Me, taking the big falls, being slammed down into the canvas, surviving an incredible onslaught before flipping the momentum, powering out of a facebuster and sensationally overcoming my opponent. I drop to one knee to contemplate my victory, then clamber up, climb through the ropes out of the ring, and work my way through the frenzied crowd to find Caitlin. I lay the belt on her hands to acknowledge that the title is something we've achieved together. Maybe get a kiss. The crowd would leap to their feet. The atmosphere is electric. And then I wake up. Never in my overcharged imagination did I think I would experience the biggest match of my life in a time warp. 1 degree removed, with no fans present. My sofa-bound self is trying hard to block out the what could have been dream montage. The magical interactive intensity of the fans' surround sound egging me on to beat the hell out of Brock Lesnar. My audience numbers 3, my wife and 2 cats. These are surreal times, however, and to be world champion, you must stand tall against all challenges. I do. 266 pounds and 6 feet 7 inches with my boots on. People say that few can match Brock Lesnar's imposing bodybuilder physique, but squaring up to him eyeball to eyeball, let me tell you, I look down on him. At 6 feet 3 inches, Brock Lesnar is nothing compared to some of the challenges I have had to overcome. My journey in wrestling has been complicated. A series of struggles and disappointments like a giant game of snakes and ladders. Ever since I was 15 years old, I've heard a word repeated. Potential, 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 ringing in my ears. When I was 24, I was branded the Chosen One by Vince McMahon, the big cheese who made WWE the global phenomenon it is today. I climbed the ranks and had the ultimate goal in wrestling in sight, only to slide back down to the bottom of the reckoning. Let me tell you, this period, personally, professionally, psychologically, was the lowest of lows. But here I am now, on the cusp of converting years of pent-up potential into blockbuster achievement. Thanks to winning a sensational Royal Rumble in January, I have earned my shot at the heavyweight title. If I win, and I sense that is what the fans really, really want, I will be the first ever British-born WWE World Champion. After kicking down every door, as well as a number of my opponent's teeth, I am back near the top of the board. It's been a long, purposeful climb up the rungs of every ladder in the wrestling business, around the world, and the ultimate prize is once again within reach. And then, just as I was ready to grasp it, a new snake slithers across my path, breathing a deadly cloud of invisible virus particles. The question was, how to bypass it to get to the top? None of the classic escape moves would rescue me from this situation, nor was it something I could finish off by running at full speed and kicking it smack in the face. I couldn't just pick up a microphone and cut a brilliant promo to inspire a U-turn in the mood of the people. With the spread of COVID-19 confirmed as a global pandemic, WWE decided the only solution was to follow World Health Organization protocols, so an empty arena match it would be. It was an irony, not lost on some of us, that a sport as technically dangerous as wrestling was forced to fall in line with social distancing precautions. On planet WWE, we larger-than-life super-strong combatants pride ourselves on prevailing against any objectionable threats that stand in our way. But we were powerless in the face of a global pandemic. The timing was such that those evil spikes of COVID contagion killed off the participatory element of our annual extravaganza. The fans who flock in for WrestleMania week, the very lifeblood of WWE. When there are tens of thousands in the arena, the stories in the ring take on their own compelling momentum. For a wrestler, it is absolutely the best feeling in the world. You're improvising in the ring, the crowd is reacting to every move, pulling its collective strings to will the action on. Everybody is on board and strapped in for the emotional roller coaster. And thanks to COVID-19, I was going to be denied that euphoria. That moment in the sun of screaming adulation of 75,000 fans, you have got to be freaking kidding me. Owing to the ban on public gatherings and the introduction of social distancing rules to keep performers safe, we were informed that WrestleMania 36 was to be pre-recorded behind closed doors at the WWE Performance Center in late March and packaged for pay-per-view and live streaming on April 5th and 6th. The dream walkout at the Raymond James Stadium, home of the NFL Tampa Bay Buccaneers, a host venue for the Super Bowl, was not to be. My big moment was to be staged in a self-contained bubble at WWE's training and developmental facility, the place where wannabe wrestlers train to see if they got what it takes. Not in front of a raucous capacity crowd in the legend-making showcase venue of the Ray J. My initial reaction, and I'm not proud of it, was anger and disappointment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.